I was like, okay, God, that's pretty awesome. So what I did was I researched the meaning of the word to give. What does it mean to give something in Hebrew? It says to freely transfer the possession or to hand over freely. So you have to make a choice to want to give this thing away with joy in your heart, to give it, to freely give it. So to let go of something is to escape from it or to let it go free. So not only are you escaping from it by God setting you free from that stronghold, but you learn to live in trusting God. And that's what the Father loves the most. So his faith pleases God. So you have to trust him. You know, I wrote down a couple of different pieces here. I wrote down the definition. Faith is the patience with the mystery. So it takes time sometimes, and you know, that's in those moments when we're like, okay, God, if you love me, you would do this. If you love me, you would let this happen. God's love is not proof. We can't look at his love as proof. Like, God knows all things. He's the beginning and the end. So, you know, we might think that we know what we want or what we need, but God the Father is the only one that knows that, and he knows the process. And so we have to learn to trust him during the process. As I always used to say, trust him. Trust the process. That has a whole new meaning to me now because I had to live out the process. And I used to get mad at God. Well, God, if you love me, why won't my aunt let me come back? You know, that used to devastate me because I didn't ask, that's not Jesus, you know? And then now I run into these people that keep asking for my help. And now because I've grown mature enough to let go, because of letting go, maturity comes, I've learned I can't help them. I can't. I want to, and it breaks my heart, but you know what? It doesn't really break my heart anymore because I know that I can trust God, my Father, with them because he loves them more. And help, if I would let them into my house, okay? Because that was my struggle. I was like, okay, well, I got a house now. I can help people. But no, that's how the enemy twists it, because if I would let them in, I'd be jeopardizing everything that God has done for me.
Amen.
The impact that Absolutely. I have on their lives now is far better than any impact I ever had before, because I have fruits and they can eat of my fruit now. And that doesn't mean, oh, come into my house and take advantage and, you know, blah, blah, blah. No, that's not what that means. That means that I am sure enough to know. God, go. He had me when my aunt told me no, he had me. I had to walk out that process. And so, that's pretty cool. And then, so I researched the word control. It is to power or to influence people's direct behavior or the course of events. How many of us as humans know, we're like, okay, my kid's not safe, what do I do? We try to take control of the situation, we try to come up with all these things.
Say it.
We get them to see the Father. You know, we're free, so we just want them to have freedom. But God is the only one that knows how to get to their heart and to paint
Amen.
The walls that are there. You can destroy it if you just
mm-hmm.
I used to tell people my mom shoved God down my throat. Mm-hmm. And it made me turn. It really did. I turned my back on God because I was just like, I don't want that, God. Look at all this hell around me, you know. I didn't want that. But God had to teach me about the process. So to surrender something is to cease resistance and to submit to all authority. Now, there are times in your life when God will send you under people as your covering and your authority. And that's what happened to me with Brittany and Brian. God sent me here. He gave me a covering for protection for me to learn and to take the words of the wise and to go with it. And I did, and it was amazing. And I'm still honoring that because they're my covering right now. I mean, the Lord is my covering, but they're my covering right now. So it's really important to find someone who is wise, you know, or who follows after God, which you have an amazing pastor. So I just, you know, think that we should all use him as a covering because he's amazing. He prays for us even when we don't know it. And so I started thinking about it more. I was like, okay, Lord, well, then what do you do when you trust him, but it hurts? You feel like you're having a heart attack. The pain's so deep, you can't breathe. Like, okay, God, what else can I do to let go? It feels like there's a golf ball in my throat, you know? It hurts somehow. God never said it wasn't going to hurt, but he said, let your heart be with you, because he knows me now. He's the God of the outcome. So trust him, even when it hurts, even when it doesn't look like Jesus, even when Peter told God, "You're not going to the cross. What did Jesus say? How did you just say, 'You get behind me'?" Because sometimes it is painful. But it's that letting go process that is necessary, because you have to completely die to yourself in every way. A thousand deaths you have to die. My aunt just taught me this yesterday. I want to help those people, but would I be willing to die for them? Would I be willing to give my life a thousand times over every day? This morning, you want to know what I prayed? I said, "Lord, help me die. Teach me to die every day. To die to myself, to things that I want, to things that I think that I need. I want to die to it. I don't want any of it." And so there's such a freedom when you realize that. I'm not even using any of my verses. Sorry, Reagan. The Lord always takes me somewhere. So I researched what heart attack meant. And it is when a blood clot blocks the flow of blood to the heart. And without blood, the tissue loses oxygen and dies. That's how we should feel about Jesus. We cannot put up these walls in our hearts, you know, the places that we lay things around, such as believing for our kids or a spouse or just any situation in your life that you've laid to die, where you said, "Okay, I can trust God with this, but I can't trust him with this." He will only go as far as you let him go. He will only come where you invite him in. So you have to daily, almost every second of the day, invite him into those areas. He is the open door. He is the open door. It says you can come in to the presence and walk through the open door and find green pastures. That's every second of your life. You can live in the secret place.
Amen.
You really develop a superpower where you are untouchable.
Amen.
Yes.
You do well in the presence of the
Lord. That's what I talk about.
At all times, and it's awesome, and it's amazing. And this is something that I've learned to do, like with taking
thank you, Lord.
Captive. It used to be extremely hard for me, because I would let my situations and my circumstances around me get in my head, and I would think, "Oh, well, if God loved me, he'd do this. If God loved me, he'd do this. If God loved me, he'd do this." No, that's not how it works. He has a different way of proving his love on a deeper level. And so that is a flesh mentality that you have to break off. So just continue to do that. I encourage you. And I'm going to skip all my other verses, Megan. So I'm just going to go into John 11:21. Hi. Welcome. Love, love, love. You look beautiful. Hey, baby. Okay, I want to go into John 11:21 because this is the story of where Mary sent the messenger to Jesus. And she said, "The one you love is sick." And it says, the key word it says in there, it says, "So he waited 2 days." The one you love is sick. So Jesus waited 2 days. So the one you love is sick. Jesus waited 2 days. Now, as you read further along in that, it says that she, when he finally came, she said, "If you would have been here, my brother wouldn't have died." How many of us do that in our lives? If you would have, like I just said, if you would have done this, if you would have done that, this could have happened, the outcome would have been this. But because he loved them, he waited 2 days. So, this is really exciting. I love this. Okay, so John 11:21. Okay, so just ignore my reading because I'm not the best either. Especially out of the King James Version, it gets me stuck sometimes. The Holy Spirit is the best reader. Okay, and it says, "Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went to meet him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, 'Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother would have not have died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou willest ask of God, God will give it to thee.'" So that's beautiful right there, because she said, even though my brother is dead, even though he's in his tomb, you are still God. You are still God Most High that can do whatever God wants to do. She still believed that, even though the outcome was not what she expected. It didn't look like what she wanted it to look like. She still knew, you are the God beyond my understanding. So that's pretty beautiful. So Jesus said unto her, "Thy brother shall rise again." And Martha said unto him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." But Jesus said to her, this is really beautiful, "I am the resurrection and the